Welcome to the Pursuit Church. I am so glad you're joining us today. Wherever you're joining us, whether it's at one of our campuses in Minot, Stanley, online, or in the Ward County Detention Center, we're so thrilled you're with us today. And I believe wholeheartedly that God has something for each and every one of you. But open your life up to Him, open your heart up to Him, and allow the Holy Spirit to minister to you today. And in case we haven't met before, my name's Tom, and we got a lot going on. In fact, this weekend, all of our locations participated in it, but we did a big event called City Serve. We partnered with another church, and we just went out into the community and just showed the love of Jesus, and I cannot wait to hear what stories emerge of how the Holy Spirit worked in people's lives. But man, thank you, thank you, thank you to every single one of you who gave time, talents, treasures to go out and minister to people. Man, God, you know God's going to use it for His glory and to do an amazing work. So, City Serve, what a powerful, powerful event. Now, before I jump my message too, I want to let you know, because this is the last week in our sermon series, we're going to be starting a brand new sermon series next week. And every time we start a brand new sermon series, it is a wonderful opportunity to invite someone to come and join you. And so at all of our locations, we put together these tools. They're called Invite Card. And what we want you to do is not just throw them in the trash on your way out or use it as a placeholder, but really think about someone in your life that you can invite to come and be a part of the sermon series. And so a little bit about the sermon series, we're going to go through the book of 1 Peter. It's going to be a little bit longer sermon series, about 8 weeks long, and we're going to go section by section. And what's so powerful about the book of 1 Peter is that in this letter that the Apostle Peter wrote, and he really speaks to a group of Christians that are going through trials and tribulations and hardships, but he talks about how to have a genuine faith, how to stay close to the heart of God, even when you're going through life's most challenging seasons. And so if you know someone who's going through a hard time, or maybe they've been through a hard time, or we know that everybody, we got hard times in front of us, this is a fantastic sermon series to come and just learn what it looks like to have a steady, solid faith no matter what life throws at you. So we're going to start 1 Peter. It's going to be so good. We'll have a Bible reading plan to go along with it. And man, we'd love to have you invite someone to come join you for the sermon series. But that's starting next week, so get ready for that. But today, we are finishing up one of our favorite sermon series we do every single summer called Mixtape. And this just happens to be volume 4. So we've done it for 4 summers now. What we do for this sermon series, if you're just joining us, is we take songs that most of y'all should know, be able to sing along to in some respect, and then we compare the messaging of it to biblical truth. Now, each summer we pick a theme, right? Because when you put together a mixtape, it's usually themed around something, whether it's love songs, breakup songs. Last year was Disney classics, and this year's theme is road trip songs. So we had to have songs that'd be epic anthems for road trips. So, last week, we kicked it way back, went old school with the song from the 60s called I Can't Get No Satisfaction, and we talked about contentment. Now, this week, we're going to go back to the newer times, and we have a song, but I think this song is like just an epic road trip song. You guys ready for the final song in our mixtape road trip edition for the sermon series? You guys ready for this? All right, let's play the clip. They tell me I'm too young to understand. They say I'm caught up in a dream. Well, life will pass me by if I don't open up my eyes. So that's fine by me. So wake me up. All right, so song number 4 in our road trip playlist is Wake Me Up by Avicii. Such a good song. I know some of y'all were singing along. You know that song. When you hear that on the radio or whenever it comes on, you crank that thing up. But some facts about the song. It was released in 2013, which I cannot believe that it was that long ago. But this thing was a mega hit around the globe. It reached the number one spot on the charts in over 20 countries around the globe. Spotify, any Spotify users, it was the first song ever on Spotify to get over 200 million streams. Like, that's crazy. On YouTube, the video, it had over 2 billion views on YouTube, making it one of the most viewed all-time videos on YouTube. Crazy, crazy, crazy. But the thing about it that's so interesting to me is that in the United States of America, it only peaked at number 4 on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100, which is kind of crazy for how big of a hit it was. Now, the song, it's attributed to Avicii, and Avicii is a famous DJ, or was a famous DJ, and he was the one who came up with the music behind it. But really, the lyrics, and that's what we're analyzing in this sermon series, the lyrics of the song were written by a guy named Allo Black. He's the one who sang on that track as well. He wrote the lyrics, and in this phrase, "Wake me up when it's all over." I love, by the way, just full disclosure, I think that line there, "Wake me up when it's all over," is like, is the theme of some of you guys that road trip. Anybody have a spouse that whenever you begin your road trip, it's like Instanap. They just go out, right? They wake up when the trip is over. That's how Shannon is. Whenever I know Shannon comes to the front seat with a blanket and a pillow, I'm like, all right, I'm on my own on this one. So that line in particular, "Wake me up when it's all over." Some of you, that is your anthem for a road trip. But all joking aside, when Allo Black was asked what the lyrics of the song were all about, he basically said, man, when he started his music career back in the 90s, he never expected in his wildest dreams that he would actually have made it. And by making, I mean traveling the world, hosting shows, making music and all those things. And so as he wrote the lyrics, he thought, man, I'm just living this dream life. And that's where that line in the song came from. Life's a dream, wake me up when it's all over. Now, the song, in essence, is about this guy, you know, Allo Black, going on this journey, getting to do what he's loved, doing something he never thought he'd be able to imagine he'd get to do. But in this song, in the chorus of the song, it has this phrase that it sings over and over and over again. And as I was preparing for this message, I just couldn't shake it, and so it shaped the direction of it. But I want to read you guys the chorus real quick, which you guys saw. But it says this: so wake me up when it's all over, when I'm wiser and I'm older. But here's the lyric that just stuck out to me. All this time I was finding myself and I didn't know I was lost. So Allo Black admits that on his journey, where he was living this dream life, he was beginning to discover who he was. And as he was discovering his identity, who he was, it dawned on him, he didn't realize just how lost he was, how he didn't really know who he was. But on the journey, it became this opportunity for him to come and get to know himself. Now, it's true. Isn't this so true that it's those journeys that God takes us on in life that are unexpected, that are hard or crazy or wild? It's like through the journey that God uses that to really help us discover who we are and what a relationship to him looks like. Man, I know for many of the people that I meet with, it seems like going through difficult seasons or moving away from home or going off to college or starting a new job or doing something that is just this crazy journey, that through that process, God begins to reveal himself in deeper ways to people's lives. And what happens when we go on a journey, typically, is there's like this shaking of our life. It's like we begin to question our foundation, we begin to question who we are. And we often go through this sort of trial and tribulation, this turmoil internally. But as we go through the journey that God has for us, on the other side comes clarity and confidence in our faith in God and who we are in him. And it's this incredible gift that God takes us on. I know for me, when I went to college, there were a lot of my peers who went to college. It was the first time that they were ever away from their home. You know, it was the first time that they had tasted independence. And all of a sudden, it was the first time they could make all the choices that they could want. They could go and they could do the things that they weren't allowed to do. They could question things and all those things. And for many of them, there was this season where it was like their life became very unsettled. But as they went on this journey, God used it to really solidify their relationship with Him. Now, some cultures intentionally create a journey experience called a rite of passage. It's like they send their young off on this journey so that when they return, they ultimately become, you know, more confident in who they are. One of the examples is the Amish community has this thing called Rumspringa. Now, if you've heard about Rumspringa before, but when an Amish teen turns 16, they're now allowed to leave the nest of their community and go experience life outside of the Amish community. In fact, it's almost encouraged, hey, go check out what's outside of the Amish community. And they get to go wear regular clothing. They get to try worldly things. And the whole purpose is they kicked them out of the nest to go sort of create this journey-like experience, this rite of passage, in hopes that as they just experience what life is like outside the nest, that they will make a decision for themselves to return to the community. And when they return to the community, it's their decision, not their parents' decision, but their decision to be a part of the community they belong to. And I think for all of us, we can relate to this experience. Some of you grew up in a Christian home, right? You grew up, your parents taught you about Jesus, you went to Sunday school, you went to Wednesday night church, you did all those things. But there has to be this moment on your journey where it's not your parents' faith, it's not your grandma's faith, but you go and you make this decision where it's your faith. I believe because I believe, not because someone told me to believe. And usually that revelation, that place comes through going on a journey. Now, I want to jump into a story in the Bible where Jesus tells the story of a young man who leaves the comfort and safety of his own home, goes out and sort of has his own Rumspringa or his own journey, but through the process discovers who he is. And it came with heartache, it came with hitting rock bottom, but ultimately God used that journey to draw him back to him. Now the story is found in Luke chapter 15, and it's one of the most famous Bible study stories out there, and it's been called the prodigal son or the lost son. But in this, I think there's so much beauty communicating God's response to us and ultimately the journey that many of us find ourselves on. So I want to work my way through this passage of scripture with us today. So if you have your Bibles, we'd love for you to turn it into Luke chapter 15, and we're going to start in verse 11 and work our way forward. So let's jump into this young man's journey of self-discovery called the prodigal son. Chapter 15, verse 11, it says this. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had and set off for a distant country and there squandered his wealth in wild living." Now, the context of this story, it's the third of three stories that Jesus tells in Luke chapter 15, which might be one of my favorite all-time chapters of scripture. And in these three parables or three stories that Jesus tells, he's talking about how God has this massive heart for the lost. That God loves and wants to draw people who are far away from him into a loving relationship with him. In the third story he tells is the story of the prodigal son, and it's like the most detailed, and we get the most vivid details of God's character and love for those of us who've maybe wandered away from our faith. But ultimately, the story Jesus tells us is there's this younger son who goes to his father, and he asks his father to divide the estate. Now, typically, the division of the state happened at the death of the dad, right? Like, you know how this works. Like, once your parents die, if they have any money, resources, assets, then it's divided up between the kids. And usually that the division of the estate happens at death. Now, it wasn't completely uncommon for a father to divide up his estate and share it with his sons before he died. But the thing that is incredibly unusual about this story was that it wasn't that the father divided the estate up, it was the fact that the son was the one who went to the father and said, "Hey, I want my share of the estate. And what he was doing when he asked his father to divide the estate up before his death is he was communicating that he wanted to break away from his father's household. In essence, it was kind of like a statement saying, like, "Dad, I no longer want to live under your roof. I want to go do my own thing. I don't want your advice. I don't want your relationship. I want freedom and independence. I want to go do my own thing. So give me my share so I can leave the family and go and do what I want. It would be like a massive slap to the face of the dad. I don't need you. I don't want to live under your household. And so what happens is the son, he takes his share of the estate, and it says he's set off for a distant country. Now, if you have your Bible open, you can underline that phrase, set off for a distant country. And there it says he squandered his wealth. But I want you to underline it because this is the son going on his journey, right? He wanted to get as far away as he possibly could from everything he knew. So he went off to a distant country and basically just went and lived his own life. And it says that he squandered his wealth on wild living. Basically, the son did all the things that he wasn't allowed to do when he lived under his father's house, right? When you live with your parents, there's rules, there's boundaries. You got to be in at a certain time. There's a curfew. Don't do this. You got to do that. All those things that a loving, responsible household entails. And so this son went off to a distant country and he just said, I'm going to do whatever I want. I'm going to try all the things I didn't get to try. I'm going to party. I'm going to drink. I'm going to, sleep around. And when it says he squandered his wealth on wild living, that's exactly what the Bible is implying, that he just went crazy nuts with his life. I mean, it'd be like someone nowadays, they just leave the home and they go and they do drugs and they party and they start sleeping around and all those things. That's what this dude was doing. But the question is that I was wrestling with in this is ultimately, what was the son looking for? Like, why did he want to leave his father's household and go on this journey away from the home? Was he searching for independence? Was he searching for freedom? And what was he truly searching for on this journey? Now, interesting in the story, the son, for just a moment, it sounds like he's living the good life, right? He goes off to a distant country. He's doing whatever he wants to do. But all of a sudden, the story goes from this high to a very low, low in the next part of it, as Jesus tells it. So verse 14 says this, after he had spent everything, like he had nothing, it says, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. And he longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. How quickly did his life turn around? Right, all of a sudden, the money ran out, and a severe famine sweeps across the land, and he finds himself homeless and broke. Like, he hits rock bottom. And so what does he do? Well, he does something that would have been so humiliating, so degrading. He came from a wealthy Jewish family, and now all of a sudden he finds himself in a foreign country, and he has to go and get a job as a servant. And not only that, but a Jewish kid has to go and feed pigs. And if you know anything about the Jewish dietary laws, right? Pigs were forbidden to eat. They were like unclean. You were not allowed to touch them, eat them, all those things. And so this wealthy Jewish kid falls from grace and is now a hired hand in a dirty, sloppy job tending to an animal that's forbidden to the Jewish culture. Like, you don't get any lower than that. Man. And when it says a severe famine hit, clearly they're talking about a physical famine where there was no water, all those things. But man, one of the commentators that I read pointed out that this famine was not just a physical famine, but it was also a spiritual famine that this young man found himself in. You see, here's the truth. This son's search for freedom and independence left him only in bondage and destitution. And man, if you're here today, you know this story. This story resonates inside of you because maybe this is your story. Maybe you rebelled against your family, your parents, and you went out and did your own thing, and you lived your own life, and you went and lived the partying lifestyle, and you denied yourself nothing. I'm going to drink. I'm going to smoke. I'm going to do drugs. I'm going to, do all the things that I wasn't able to do. And in the moment, it seemed like this really high, but all of a sudden, you woke up the next morning, and then it hit you like a ton of bricks. that maybe, just maybe, this search for freedom and independence has left you in a state of bondage and destitution? You've been there before? And just speaking to y'all right now, maybe you're in the room today and you feel like you're in a famine season. You feel like you're in a famine right now, not just physically, but spiritually. You feel dry. You feel like there's a drought in your life. But I want to encourage you, because this story is a story of hope, that God can pull you out of that famine, that God can pull you out of that place of bondage and destitution into a beautiful relationship with Him. And so hang in there. If you find yourself in a famine spiritually right now, there's something powerful in this story for you. So the man in the story, right, he hits rock bottom. He squanders all his wealth on wild living. He found himself homeless, working for a foreign farmer, tending to an animal that's forbidden to him. Well, here's what happens. The next verse tells us, verse 17. It says this, when he came to his senses. And I'm hoping that right now, some of y'all in service today, maybe this is the moment where you come to your senses, right? Maybe you have a moment of spiritual clarity. It says, when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have had food to spare? And here I am starving to death. He says, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you, and I am no longer to be worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. It says, so he got up and went to his father. Now, love that phrase. So he came to his senses. Now, other translations of the Bible say, it says he came to himself. It's like he woke up, like self-discovery, identity. It was this moment of clarity. Like, I am not living the life that I want to live. I am not the man that I want to be. I am not the person that I want to be. This moment of clarity. And maybe you've had that where you're sitting here today and you go, man, I've tried so many things in this life, but I realize that I'm on the wrong path, that I'm going in the wrong direction, that I'm not becoming the man or the woman that I really want to be. I'm hoping today that maybe some of you come to your senses spiritually, that you have a moment of spiritual clarity. And when it dawns on him that this life that he thought that he wanted really wasn't cracked out what it was to be, it says he realized that he needed to make a change. Now, what's interesting is when he came to his senses, what did he realize that he was missing? What did he realize that he was longing for? Well, it says in the Bible, it says, I thought this is really fascinating, it says, I will go back to my father. I will go back to my father. When he came to his senses, what he realized that he wanted the most was his dad. What his soul longed for, it wasn't just the home, and it wasn't the food, and it wasn't the roof over his head. It says, I will go back to my father. What he longed for the most was relationship with his dad. And so what does he do? The son puts together this speech where he says, I'm going to go back to my father and I'm going to tell him that I've sinned against heaven and I've sinned against him and he's no longer to be worthy to be called his son, and he just wants to be received back to the father. And so then he gets up and he begins this journey of going back to the father. And ultimately he wants his father to accept him back, even if it's not as a son, but even as a hired hand, because he longs for the relationship with his dad. Now, obviously, in the story that Jesus is telling in Luke 15, the Father represents God, and the Son in the story represents us. And I believe wholeheartedly that what you and I truly long for in our soul is an intimate relationship with God. And some of you are living your life and you're searching for meaning, you're searching for identity, you're searching for purpose, you're searching for freedom, you're searching for independence. But behind all of that search, you know what I believe that you're really searching for is a relationship with Jesus. Now, you wouldn't be able to intuitively articulate it, but that insatiable search in your soul, you know what it is? That's a God-given thing that God put inside of you that he wants to use to ultimately draw you to him. What you're longing for is a relationship with God, the Father. Now, I've preached this passage multiple occasions because, like I said, it's one of the greatest stories of Scripture. But when I was studying this passage of scripture, something about it stood out to me that I'd never seen before. You know, at the beginning of the story in verse 12, the son goes to the father and he says, "Give me my share of the estate. Give me," this phrase, "give me my share of the estate." But when he comes to his senses, when he has this moment of spiritual clarity, his requests of the father change. In verse 19, he shifts from "give me" to "make me." He says, "Make me like one of your hired hands." Now, this phrase is a massive transition in where he's at spiritually. He goes from "God, give me, give me, give me," to "God, make me, make me, make me." The son went from seeing his relationship with the father as one who just gives him stuff, to now he sees his dad as one who can transform him. Make me, make me, make me. Now, how many of you, I mean, I think most of us in this room, we all pray, right? You know, even people who don't even call themselves devout followers of Jesus, most people pray at some point in their life. But before you get to know God or develop an intimate relationship, most of our prayers is about "give me, give me, give me. God, will you give me this? Will you grant me that? Will you do this for me?" But man, when you get to know God in the deepest sense, we still ask him for things, but much of our prayer life changes to this: "God, make me, shape me, mold me, transform me, change my heart, change my desires. God, help change this sinful pattern of my health. God, make me more like you." And I'm telling you, when you come back to God, the relationship with God is so much more than what he has to offer you, his hand. It's the relationship with him that is so life-changing. Make me, make me, make me. God, make me more like you. So the son has this transition in his heart where he desires a relationship with his father, and it says he heads back home. Now, this last part, I tell you what, is so incredible. We get to see how the father, or the father who represents God, how God responds to us when we turn to him, when we come back to him. And here's what it says in verse 20 through 24. So the son heads home, and it says this: "But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him." And it says he ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. And the son said to him, he starts to give this prepared speech. He says, "Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son." He says, "But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate, for the son of mine was dead and is alive again.'" And check out this language: "He was lost and is found." And so they began to celebrate. So like I said, this is a picture of what happens when you and I return to God, when we come home to God. You see, when we come to God with a heart of repentance, of, "Man, God, I have squandered my life. I have done some things that have been sinful. I've done some things that have wronged. I've turned my back on you. I've ran from you." And we have this moment of clarity and we go, "Lord, I'm going to come back to you." And you seek forgiveness and you seek relationship with him. Man, God responds with incredible love. I love this. It says the father saw him while he was a long way off. Now, it doesn't tell us for sure, but it's easy to imagine that almost every morning, every day, the father would scan the horizon looking for his son, just hoping and waiting that his son would come home. And when he sees his son, he's not filled with anger, but it says he was compassionate, and he runs to his son. And here's the thing: I don't know how you lived your life in the past. I don't know if your life has been marked with rebellion and sin and shame. And some of you, you're afraid to come home to God because you're afraid that you'll be met with anger and judgment. But here's the thing: when you come back to God with in a heart of repentance, God comes to you with compassion and love. Now, here's what's amazing about the story is you know, I'm a dad of three little girls. And when my daughters like totally rebel and they turn their back on me and they, you know, disobey me. And it's like a clear like disobedience to me. You know what they usually get is they get discipline and they get some sort of consequence. What's amazing is think about the story. The son took the estate, went off to a distant country, squandered it, doing all these bad things. And what did the son deserve from like, you know, an earthly standpoint? What did the son deserve? Like what would have been an appropriate response by the dad? It should have been anger. It should have been wrath. It should have been some sort of punishment or consequence. You know, it should have been sort of like banishment from the family, rejection, right? But what does the father do? What does he receive instead of what he should receive? Well, he receives grace and mercy. Now, this story, the prodigal son and the lost son, is a picture of the gospel. It's what it is. It's a picture of the gospel. You see, when you come to Jesus with a heart of repentance, you get grace and mercy instead of wrath and punishment. You see, the truth is, the Bible tells us that the wages of our sin is death, that our sin, our rebellion deserves death, it deserves hell, it deserves wrath and punishment. But when you turn to God, we're met with compassion and grace and mercy. It's this incredible thing that happens. Now, here's what I want to tell you. Repentance is always met with mercy and love. And I will tell you, if you're in the room today, there is no sin that you cannot out-sin God's mercy. You cannot out-sin God's grace. You think your life has a mountain of sin and shame? Well, guess what? God's grace and mercy is even greater. And here's the invitation, is that if you are ready to come back to God, if you're ready to come to Him with a heart of repentance, God, I messed up. Forgive me. I've wandered away from you. And you come to the foot of the cross and you confess that before Him. You don't get the hammer. You get His mercy and grace. It's this incredible gift that we get. And the Father runs to the Son in the story. I love this. Because the father running to the son is such an undignified thing for a grown man to do. In fact, in the Bible times, like when Jesus was telling this story, that would have been like, you know, a father shouldn't just run. Like that's just, you know, you don't just go out and run. Like that would have been this undignified act. He grabs his son. He hugs him. He kisses him. Like, whoa. But that's what God does for us when we come to Him. And then it says He gave His son a robe, a ring, sandals, kills the fattened calf. And what He was doing is He was communicating to the son that you are not just a servant, that I am going to give you a job, but you are my son and I'm restoring you to full sonship. What a beautiful story in Luke 15 about God's love for those of us who maybe wandered away but come back to Him. It's incredible. It's incredible. What a beautiful story. Now think about the song that led to this conversation, right? That song by Avicii, or the lyrics written by Aloe Black. And he says, man, on his journey, he was discovering himself and he didn't even realize that he was lost. And maybe in the life that you've been living, you've been on this journey, and in the journey, you're discovering who you are, you're discovering that you've made some mistakes, you realize that maybe you've been lost, maybe you've been going wandering in the wrong direction. Well, I want to encourage you that it's not too late to turn back to God, to come home to God. So here's how I want to close out this message today, okay? Here's what I want to do. I want to ask some personal to you. Have you been running from God? Have you been searching for freedom and independence only to discover that it led to bondage and destitution? Because I believe at the heart of your journey, the search in your soul, the heart is that you're really longing for a relationship with God. What you're really longing for is that relationship with God the Father that's found through Jesus Christ. And so here's what I want to do is in all of our locations, I'll invite you guys to stand up with me right now. Go ahead and stand up with me. And here's what I want you to do is I want you to bow your head and I want you to close your eyes and I want you to just have a moment. Right? You know the journey you've been on. You know where you're at spiritually. You know whether you've wandered away from God or whether you've just your whole life have had your back turned to God, but you're here today. And the fact that you're in church today, the fact that you're at service tells me something, that you want to know who God is. You want to start a relationship with Him. If you're here today and you've and you've never started a relationship with God, you're ready to come back to the Father and begin that journey. You're ready to come to Him with a heart of repentance to confess that you've wandered away, that you've done some things that you're not proud of, but you're ready to come to Him in a place of belief and repentance. Here's what I want you to do. With every eye closed and every head bowed, if that's you, you're ready to come back to the Father. Here's what I want you to do. Just put your hand up high. Put your hand up high. Now, there's nothing special about putting your hand up in service, but sometimes just raising your hand is a demonstration of this desire in your heart to come back to God, to come to God, to come to Jesus. Go ahead and put your hand up. If you're giving your life to Christ for the very first time, what a massive step. Start a relationship with Him. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to pray for you in just a moment. And our great heart as a local church is that we could come alongside you on this journey, help you discover what it looks like to walk with God, to start a relationship with Him. But man, the invitation right now is to come back to Him. Now, with your eyes closed and head bowed, some of you, man, you grew up in the church. You've known what a relationship with Jesus looks like, but maybe in this season you've wandered away from Him. You've just sort of, you know, squandered things. You've sort of ran away from God, but today you're ready to come back to Him, kind of rededicate your life, reignite that relationship with Him. If that's you, go ahead and put your hand up too. Go ahead and raise your hand up. Man, if you put your hand up too, what a powerful moment returning back to the Father today. But here's what I want to do. I want to pray for everybody who's raised their hand, whether it's to start a relationship with Jesus for the first time or whether it's to come back to the relationship with Jesus that you once knew and tasted. I just want to pray for you right now that you'd experience God's compassion, His love, His mercy, and that He would do a forgiving and transforming work in your life right now. Lord Jesus, thank You for those who are at service today. God, You have them here for a reason, and I don't know what their past month has looked like, their past 6 months, their past season of life has been. But for many people in the room today, they've been on that journey of discovery. But God, they're having this moment of clarity. They're coming to their senses spiritually, and they realize that what they've been missing and longing for this whole time is a relationship with You. And I pray for those specifically who raised their hand to start a relationship with You the first time. Would You meet them in their repentant heart? God, would You forgive them of their sins? God, would You give them that peace that can only come through Your Spirit? And God, would You help them to begin a powerful and amazing journey of walking with You? And I pray for those that raise their hand to come back to God, that maybe they knew You or have known You, but they just wandered away. But today they're coming back to You to rededicate their life to You, to recommit their life to You. God, would You minister to them now? Would You hear the cry of their heart? Would you meet their repentance with grace and mercy once more? God, minister in this place. Move in the hearts of all of us today. But thank You so much that You're a God who's patient with us. And God, that You use our wandering as a way to draw us back to You. Minister to us now. Move in power. I ask this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.